Good morning to you all. It's a great honor to speak today and a pleasure to meet you and participate in this meeting. The theme of this morning, spaces, is most appropriate. New spaces have been designed for the Rijksmuseum and old spaces have been given a new meaning. In the first part of my presentation, I will pay attention to the spectacular new spaces of the Rijksmuseum, designed by the Spanish architects Cruz and Ortiz. And in the second part, I will discuss the tensions between the space of the historic Great Library Hall and the demands of a modern scholarly art historical library. From a distance, the Rijksmuseum looks like a fairy tale castle with 8 turrets towering high above the surrounding houses. As one gets closer, the stained glass windows in the frontage stand out, giving the building the look of a cathedral. The Rijksmuseum building is designed by Pierre Cuypers and dates from 1885. At the start of this new millennium, with facades blackened by more than a century of exhaust fumes and pollution, and the interior in urgent need of renovation and remodeling to meet the demands of the modern age, it was high time for a facelift. The museum was looking shabby and unloved. The root of the problem was that the museum had been turned into a labyrinth by the heavily built-up inner courtyards. Every aid to orientation had been cut away or camouflaged. The worst abuse took place between 1959 and 1969, when both the roofed inner courtyards on either side of the central axis were filled with building structures. That did, however, provide an auditorium with almost 400 seats and 30 new galleries, but it robbed the passageway of light. Furthermore, everything that was freely accessible had been stolen away from the public. Spaces had been transformed into storage and library depot, offices and workshops. The light of day needed to return, even in the basement. So it was recognized that the building had been neglected. The Rijksmuseum renovation project began in 1999 with a government scheme to celebrate the millennium with a series of grand cultural projects. The government reserved 100 million guilders, about 45 euros, for this project. It was a gift to the people for the new millennium. In the end, the new Rijksmuseum was trumpeted into the new century for an estimated amount of 375 million euro. That takes into account the main building, but also the atelier building, the Asian pavilion, the new entrance building, and the Philips wing. Everyone was in agreement about one aspect, the structure that Pierre Cuypers had designed in the build-up to 1885, had to return. On this map, you can see that the building has a central axis, an east and west wing, and with the Gallery of Honor as the backbone for the art on the first floor. The motto of the invited competition was Continue with Cuypers. A program was conceived that included the modernization of the building, a new entrance, and improvements in structural and museum-related conditions. Architects were invited and asked to give their vision of dealing with new functions in the existing building, the integration of the Asian pavilion, and the installations for climate control. Particular attention was paid to the new public entrance and to the coherence of each separate plan with Pierre Cuypers' dominant architecture. One of the 7 competing architectural bureaus, there was only one that sought the solutions in the museum itself. the Spanish Cruciatis architectos elegantly sketched a plaza under and on both sides of the passageway. Furthermore, they relocated the existing entrance through the two front doors to the heart of the passageway. In Cruz and Ortiz's concept, the inner courtyards were transformed into an atrium, an urban square that would function as a membrane, receiving the public and channeling them to the treasures on the floors above. This became the heart of the new museum. The reason that Cruz and Ortiz were invited to take part in the Rijksmuseum competition was that they had proved to be proficient in so-called urban repair in Sevilla. Cruz and Ortiz found that the Rijksmuseum had been abused. A warm welcome had been missing for some time, as well as the unity between the galleries and other spaces. Their winning design was the most brilliant because it does justice to the design of the 1885 building. They have restored it and given it a push into the future. Continue with Kuipers, Sender, Cruz and Ortiz. However, it was a very optimistic scenario. The Rijksmuseum would close in 2003 and reopen in 2006. It's a large historic building which needed modernizing. And we live in a time with many regulations, monumental, environmental, European, local, and so on. Then there was a lot of complications, asbestos, for example. The remodeling of the Rijksmuseum has been shaped in a fundamental way by Amsterdam's cycling lobby. The architect Pierre Kuipers was compelled by the city government to design a museum around the road that would lead out into the southern suburbs. You see the road on this map in the middle of the plan. As a result, the museum's ground floor consists of two large courtyards separated by the central passageway, which functioned as a cycleway. That means that it is only at first floor level and above that visitors can walk uninterrupted from one side of the museum to the other. At the outset of the project, the museum decided to eliminate this eccentric inconvenience and close the passageway so that the space it occupied could become a new main entrance. However, cyclists are a kind of holy cow in the Netherlands. Cycling is a very, very emotional subject that shows the Dutch character at its optimum. The passageway is being kept open for cyclists for sentimental reason, because it's so nice. This disappointment was a creative challenge for the architects of the transformation. From their analysis of the museum, Cruz and Ortiz came to the conclusion that the most important element of the Rijksmuseum had become this passageway. This passage functioned better as a gateway than the museum did as a museum. The new entrance became one of the most important modernizations of the building. In the past, visitors entered the museum via the two small towers on the front side at Stadhouderskade. Cruz and Ortiz now proposed the radical relocation of the entrance to a spacious entrance square. This square was to replace the museum's two inner courtyards, resulting in a single large new square. Over the years, the inner courtyards have been crammed with small buildings, which now have been removed to make way for the entrance square. New cellars under the inner courtyard and around the museum compensate for the lost space. Its solution was to dig down in order to link the separate halves of the museum by means of this new atrium that extends beneath the two courtyards that flank the passageway. What Cruz and Ortiz had done can be compared with the way that architect Pei linked the two wings of the Louvre in Paris with an underground atrium beneath his glazed pyramid. The concept of an atrium functioning as a distribution station was actually introduced for the first time by the Louvre. If you receive the crowd with care, in the first instance, it will automatically create more peace and quiet further on in the galleries. People are entitled to a break, and that need is met in the atrium and in the transitional areas. A museum requires spaces without art or decorative distraction in order to neutralize your view so that you can absorb new experiences. Ironically, with its new entrance, the new Rijksmuseum is more generously spacious than the Louvre. This is the main reason of the length of time the project took. The atrium is a vast space, and excavating from underneath the museum in the Amsterdam loose, waterlogged soil was a major feat of technology as well as design. The Rijksmuseum rests on 8,000 heavily laden wooden piles. To build the cellars, it was necessary to remove not only the buildings, but also the piles on which they rested. With the gentle sloping foyer that continues under the passageway to the Grand Café and the museum shop on the east side, the atrium has become a great welcoming space. Every facility of importance to a modern museum will be found here. Information and ticket booths, cloakroom, toilets, restaurant, shops. Here we are face to face with a monument within a monument. The slender security gates made from Portuguese natural stone Gasconha Azul provide an elegant welcome to the visitor. Natural stone staircases blend in with the 19th century facade, and it's striking that the new interventions are so logical and natural that they hardly attract attention. The natural stone floor consists of a melange with a refined composition of colors. The visible tints are light brown and even blue. On both sides of the atrium are adorned by two white sculptural chandeliers, which break up the enormous scale of the space and fulfill the dual role of enhancing the acoustics and illuminating the space. Underneath this atrium is an intimate auditorium that can be reached via subtle steps. But the most surprising of all is the passageway that represented a desolate tunnel for half a century. With its new paving and lights, it has become a place with potential due to the details that are now more visible and the panorama over the inner courtyards. The light from the foyer streams into the once dark tunnel. That was the image Koes and Tortijs had in mind, a museum with a remarkable inner street. And they could picture it, how you would see cyclists and passers-by from the new inner courtyards. Who is looking at whom from here? It would make the museum one of the most exciting in the world. As a visitor, you should get the feeling of a space the architects foresaw, a hall that is broken only by the passageway cutting through the museum as a sort of foot and cycle bridge. The enormous windows make it part of the entrance hall, so visitors do not experience it as a disruption. Koes and Tortijs brought light and air to the heart, following the primary goal of giving the building back to the public. Apart from two additions on the south side, the key has been sought in the heart of the building on either side of this passageway. There is an entrance that provides the visitor with a warm welcome. So an important correction has been made with respect to the concept originally created by Pierre Cuypers. He considered placing the entrance in the passageway, where he had two locations in mind, but he bowed to the pressure from the city council. At this point, it's instructive to show you a short animation of the transformation of this passageway and the virtual walk through one of the entrances into the atrium and the Grand Café as it was originally designed by Cruzan Tortiz. We start with the former situation, the dark tunneling passageway, and we see it transformed. On the left side, these walls are going to break up. In the meantime, the pavement is changing into a gray. It became actually a red bricks, but. And here you have an impression while entering the museum through one of the four revolving doors. In the first week, people were so stunned coming into this hall that they tumbled down the stairs. We had quite a lot of accidents. And these are the slender passages into the museum. So the square with the shop and the restaurant is a public square, it's a city square, and to enter the museum, you need a ticket, of course. Now, we go out again, it's just to have an impression. So this is the other side. They dig down so that you can go under this inner road, and on the right there is a cloakroom, and on the left is the ticket booth, and in the other atrium, the east side, there is a shop downstairs, actually two layers, and the Grand Café. And here we have a look at the inner street. And Cruzan Ortiz added the cyclists, which are so essential for the Dutch spirit. A few words about the main staircase, the Grand Hall, the Gallery of Honor, and the Night Watch Gallery. The main staircase and the Grand Hall form a coherent whole. Just a few words. Because they are not new, but largely restored in their entirety to its original state, including the canvases, the terrazzo flooring, and the paneling. The Grand Hall and the Gallery of Honor together form the backbone of the building. Visitors can again stroll across the inlaid mosaic floor, full of symbols and mythical figures, and let their eyes linger on the painted scenes covering the walls and the stained glass windows with their historic figures. High above is an elaborately decorated vaulted ceiling. The Grand Hall leads into the Gallery of Honor, which makes a completely different impression. Whereas the spacious Grand Hall invites visitors to linger and study the wall paintings, the long Gallery of Honor has one direction and focus, straight through to the Night Watch Gallery. Visitors are led as if in a church to the high altar, the Night Watch. Visitors who resist this temptation and go into the side galleries will find paintings by the great masters of the Golden Age. Just as radical as this architectural intervention is the new way that the collections are displayed. The museum opted for a mixed installation, combining the collections of different art forms such as paintings, glass, ceramics, silver, costumes, weapons, furniture. It's no longer the object or the material that determines the arrangement. It is about the meaning of each object as part of a larger chronological story. Art and history should be presented as an intertwined whole. The Rijksmuseum is showing Netherlands' most precious treasures from the Middle Ages to the days of Mondriaan and even beyond. Visitors should be led on a chronological route, which would give them an impression of the tastes and styles of different periods. This is our way of giving our visitors a sense of beauty and an awareness of time. The new installation has been designed by the Frenchman Jean-Michel Wilmot. He is often referred to as the master of the display case, which is one of the reasons why in 2004 he was selected to carry out the refurbishment of the Rijksmuseum. Wilmot created the transparent showcases and has treated the vaulted rooms with sensitive restraint, painting the walls in rich colors, dark for the medieval rooms, and getting lighter as the centuries pass. The Asian Pavilion. Kroes and Ortiz has been responsible not only for the atrium, but also the new galleries for the museum's Asian collections and the entrance building. The collection of Asian art fell outside of the chronologically presented art in the museum, so a separate and independent wing should be designed. This new natural stone Asian pavilion is placed in a shallow pool on the south side of the museum. The irregular shaped two-story structure with its walls of pale Portuguese stone and glass stands out against the red brick walls of the main building. It's characterized by many oblique walls and unusual sight lines. The pavilion is linked to the main building via a ground-level passageway. The museum's rich collection of Asian art is harmoniously presented in the 485 square meter space with approximately 350 objects on display. This pavilion is part of the garden design, where it is integrated as a folie or objet trouvé. A jewel is what Kroes & Ortiz has devised, with galleries above and below ground, alcoves for kimonos, temple clothes, and statues. The atmosphere inside this white Asian pavilion is light, of an almost zen-like quality. The atelier building, which is the large building you see from here, and it extends way back in this direction, was opened in 2007 as the first structure that Kroes & Ortiz completed as part of the Rijksmuseum renovation. It is intended for the preservation and management of Dutch cultural heritage and is home to the state-of-the-art Center for Restoration and Conservation, scientific practice, research and education in this field. It accommodates all restoration departments of the museum, but also the University of Amsterdam and the Netherlands Cultural Heritage Agency have offices in this building. Covering a surface area of more than 9,000 square meters, the atelier building merges as a new structure with an existing building designed by Pierre Cuypers. Functionality was paramount in the building's design. The unusual zigzagging roof structure, the glazed northern elevation, and the angled triangular windows on the side wall ensure that only northern light is admitted, protecting the works that are being restored from direct sunlight. On the opposite side, between the Cuypers Villa and the drawing school, Kroes & Ortiz have placed another small building, the new service entrance, offering access to the museum via an underground passageway. This building is also the entrance to the energy ring, a facility crucial to the museum's operation. The new nearly 500 meter long tunnel around the building houses all the technical facilities, the climate control system, electronics, security, etc. The garden, as the new outdoor museum, The Rijksmuseum starts before the entrance. Since the reopening, the garden has become a green outdoor gallery of impressive proportions of 14,800 square meters, where a special part of the collection is permanently displayed. The gardens surround the Rijksmuseum and feature several of the original formal garden styles, as well as restored classical statues, fragments, and ornaments of historic buildings from the Netherlands. More recent National Heritage objects, such as post-war playground equipment by architect Aldo van Eyck, a 19th century greenhouse with forgotten vegetables, but also a fountain, a water artwork designed by Jeppe Hein, are newly added elements. Although the garden is very much part of the museum, it's also a 21st century city park. Everyone is welcome here to buy an ice cream at the former tea house, have lunch on the terrace, play around in the fountain, and enjoy the garden. The Philips Wing is currently being renovated to turn it into a space that will hold the major exhibitions. A Friends Room is also being added, along with an à la carte restaurant featuring an outdoor terrace. Architect Cruz and Ortiz is responsible for leading the design. The Philips Wing will reopen in late 2014. To give you another impression of the original design and the positioning of the entrance building, the new passage, and the Asian Pavilion, I will show you a virtual walk around the museum, and we start from the backside to Museum Square, and the walk is through the garden, which, remember, this is an animation of about 10 years old, so the garden design was not yet there. This is the entrance building, which we will not enter. It's the same stone, Portuguese stone, used for the Asian Pavilion. So this gives you a good impression how these buildings are situated. On the left is the drawing building, which is the educational center. And now we will go to the front of the building, the side facing the center of Amsterdam. And here you see the former entrances on the left and on the right. And now we go into the tunnel, into the passageway, to have a look. Into the new atrium. The Asian Pavilion. Behind is the library wing. And back again. On the left is the Philips Wing, which is now being renovated. That was the only part of the museum that stayed open between 2003 and 2013. Okay. I would like to conclude the first part of my lecture with a tribute to Cruz and Ortiz. Their architectural style is reputed to be differential, possibly restrained. They do not like ego tripping. They are bringing a tribute to the monument the way it is. They did not look too closely for the contrast or even the conflict with the existing architecture. Ultimately, the building is secondary to the art on display. According to Antonio Cruz, the restoration entailed more than the Kuiper's decorations. quote, "I prefer to describe it as recuperation, recovering the architectural qualities of this building as a whole," unquote. The Spanish architects have done everything they could to bring back the sense of light and space without seeking too great a contrast between old and new. Cruz and Ortiz, nonetheless, had no desire to blend anonymously into the building. How successful they have been is clear from the atrium. This new space is their masterpiece. The changes are unmistakably modern, but at the same time, they bring the building back. In my opinion, they succeeded completely. The Rijksmuseum Research Library is situated in the west wing of the main building. Right there. It says Bibliothek. And it can be reached at the first floor after passing through the first 19th century gallery. That's the gallery which says Waterloo. So entering the museum, you go up the steps, and then this is the way to go. The library is an academic art history library maintaining a constant high standard acquisition policy since 1885. The main goals are the provision of factual information to support the Rijksmuseum's mission and the expansion of the library's position as an academic art history library of national and international significance. The library aims to keep the quality of the collection at a high level and to maintain it as well as possible to fill in gaps and to guarantee access to the information available, improving it where possible. The library's collection profile is in line with the various Rijksmuseum collections. The original core of the collection is the history of painting, prints, drawings, the applied arts, sculpture in Western Europe from the Middle Ages to the 20th century. Photography was added in the 70s. The library pursues a collection policy aimed at comprehensiveness in all these areas. Other key areas are the history of Asian art, collecting, restoration, conservation, and artists' manuals. The Rijksmuseum Research Library and the Department of Prints and Drawings are together responsible for the collection of books containing original illustrations, and books with original photo illustration are also jointly managed. For the first time in history, the general public will get access to this part of the museum. The library will not only be, in terms of its overall impression, the closest to the architect's conception, but also in terms of its use. The restoration of this great library hall is part of the concept of the new Rijksmuseum. This means that the alterations that were made in the past were reversed, and the original features, which were still largely discernible, properly restored. Since 1923, the museum building, as well as the decoration, underwent profound changes with modifications and overpaintings. The library is one of the rooms with a representative amount of authentic decoration that is restored. Its decoration and functional elements lead together to one harmonious piece of art, in contrast to other European art library buildings of that time. In the general composition of the rooms, Kuipers followed the concept of three clearly separated sections. His plans included a reading room, as well as a stack room for books and facilities for staff and administration. But Kuipers paid the most attention to the book repository. The reception is an impressive 20-meter-high rectangular book hall. It has a footprint of 11 by 17 meters. At the southwest side, a forged helical stair connects the three levels of the room. Iron columns support the galleries. A glass barrel vault, which extends over the whole length, naturally illuminates the repository. Three drawn-out round-arched windows on the southern side spent additional daylight. Initially, Kuipers planned 88 bookcases that encircle the hall on the galleries, which offer space for about 1 kilometer of books. His composition, with several floral decorations and plated iron holders, underlined the intention not only to store the largest possible number of books, but also to put them into a representatively designed frame. The architect paid attention to every detail. The books being stored on the walls of each gallery, as well as the decoration, becomes part of the Gesamtkunstwerk. In this hall of printed knowledge meet science and art inside the Rijksmuseum. Thanks to the profound reconstruction, this idea can be perceived once again. Features that are now being seen as delightfully old-fashioned, such as the reading room's glass roof, were the height of modernity when the library opened in 1885. People could read by daylight instead of flickering gaslight. In 1885, the reading room became the first public space in Amsterdam fitted with electrical lighting. The present solution is daylight and permanent artificial lighting that mimics the daylight. There's no doubt that there are rapid technological changes in academic libraries. Massive changes in the area of research, as well as knowledge production or publishing, are influencing the way of research. New forms of information retrieval emerge, as well as new ways of learning. The focus is transformed from collection to connection and storage to access. Modern library services should support knowledge creation rather than its consumption. The library itself was built around the needs, wishes, and desires in a future scenario where books are enrichment to society and culture. What kind of services will the Rijksmuseum Research Library be able to offer under the given circumstances? How does a reading room function as a showroom? Is it possible to combine the needs and responsibilities of a research library with the wants of an exhibition room inside a museum? Is Kuiper's intention of 1885 feasible in a museum that is expecting more than 2 million visitors per year? We took advantage of an offer by the architecture historian from Berlin, Melanie Vogel, to investigate the requirements of a research library back in the 19th century, as well as nowadays, and how they were transformed into the totally new challenge of fitting into a museum. Her survey brings to the surface the differences between the ideal situation as we had envisaged and the actual situations during the month after the opening. The following discussion is based on her most illuminating observations, which will be published this winter in the German Art Libraries journal AKMB Magazine. According to the Rijksmuseum's vision, the reading room in the Great Library Hall is intended for visitors who, inspired by what's on offer in the museum, want to go into further detail on the history and art of the Netherlands and elsewhere. Museum visitors are welcome to look something up or linger to enjoy their visit a little longer. There's no doubt that it is a unique experience for visitors of the museum to get a look inside the Great Library Hall. The rich decor and iconography of the room speaks for itself. Already the Rijksmuseum's five earliest guides from 1887 refer to the library hall on their maps. Annual reports from 1886 express the royal decision that the Rijksmuseum library consists of one great room that should be open to the public. In the reading room itself, Kuipers made this purpose well clear. One of the cartouches on the west side of the hall reads, "Hier is wetenschap der kunst een zaal gewijd," which can be translated as, "Here the science of art has a dedicated room." Besides the decorative aspect, Kuipers Library fulfilled the requirements of a research library of that time. The reading room provided enough space for the books in one repository. The additional study room gave scholars a decent place to work. Technical facilities of that time were also included in the design. A flexible and format suitable system for the storage of the books enabled them to be arranged by size without any loss of space. For protection against dust, bugs, and light, felt pelmets were fixed onto each shelf. The reading room was well illuminated by natural light through a glass barrel vault extending over the whole room. After the reconstruction of the reading room, which was finished in 2012, nearly all of Kuiper's original designs can be found again in the library hall. The illumination of the room received the additional support from electrical light, and the new desks are generous of proportion, wireless, provided by plug-in sockets for laptops and lit by task lamps. The main question that concerned us basically, what are the demands of to a research library at the beginning of the 21st century? Is it possible for this art library that is put into this 19th century look to address the needs of its modern scholars? Libraries in general are still in a transformation from print to electronic media. The 15th and 16th century scriptoriums were significant sources for new editions in electronic form. The library staff has to become competent advisors in terms of the use of electronic information media as well as the prints. The hybrid library has to offer this media mix, but there's no doubt that the printed book will remain a handy analog medium of great interest. A large audience should explore the fascination of book culture in an attractive surrounding. The Rijksmuseum Research Library, with this great library hall as a cultural monument, is an ideal place to connect people with the fascination of book culture. But how can the important services of a modern research library are integrated with the new aspect of the showroom? In 2011, I formulated the final version of the program of requirements for the library, in which I differentiated between the three user groups: the museum visitor interested in further information, the external scholar, and the scientific museum staff. The museum has also an educational function. Its library plays an important role in the knowledge transfer. Besides offering the ordinary services for researchers, the library should mainly address the first group, the museum visitor, by providing easy access to information on the museum and by serving as a meeting place where visitors can ask specialists about the collection. Thus, for instance, the easy accessible reference books on the ground floor should be pre-selected according to the actual works on display in the museum. But it's not only about providing information, but also offering a framework for education in terms of interior and furniture. It should facilitate works in groups, discussions, and joint development of ideas in order to promote communication instead of mere consumption. Large tables, sufficient chairs, and their placement shall support this aspect. So I demanded two large reading tables with 25 chairs and sockets for electronic devices, and two additional large tables, including chairs, to guarantee at least 36 chairs for educational programs. The first experience is since the opening of the reading room. After almost a decade of reconstruction and renovation, the Rijksmuseum Research Library reopened on April the 23rd, 2013, only 10 days after the official opening of the museum. The largest art research library of the Netherlands has become accessible to the general public during 7 days a week from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. An average of 6,000 on weekly days to 12,000 visitors on Saturdays and Sundays and in holidays are eager to explore the museum as well as its unique reading room. The architect Pierre Kuipers made it well clear on the outside of the museum building that there should be a separate entrance to access the art library. A relief above the entrance on the northwestern side of the building refers to the room hidden behind with the inscription Bibliotheque, Library. Unfortunately, this former separate entrance has not been reopened again. As a result, every visitor, including scholars, has to take the main entrance. Without an appointment, one must stand in line to get into the building. And for security reasons, one has to line up again for the cloakrooms, and then afterwards again for the ticket office. Immediately after entering the reading room, one experiences a totally new atmosphere. There is some noise of visitors chatting about the wonderful room, taking pictures, or even talking to beloved ones at home on their mobile phones. While most of them experience the Great Library Hall as an impressive exhibition room reflecting Kuiper's 19th century design, some approach the service staff to inquire further information. In the first week, each visitor entering the reading room was meant to be approached by library personnel for a short introduction on the room and its collection. This, however, led to noise and constant chatting in the reading room and neglected the needs of the academic library user. For those visitors who just want to experience the atmosphere of the library hall, it seems possible to open it only at the mezzanine level. The architecture could be assimilated and transferred into a showcase. The public would get access to overview the whole reading room, just like one large exhibit, without interfering with the scholars. Of course, the experience of wandering around the Hall of Books on the ground level would get lost, as well as the accessibility for interested museum visitors. A more suitable solution might be to allow in-depth researchers to use the adjacent study room of prints, drawings, and photographs for their studies. The number of working desks inside the library hall seems to be enough. We almost never experienced that all the tables would be occupied by the average number of 36 scholars. But then there would be the possibility to use this attached study room. The priority of this room is to examine the prints, drawings, and photographs from the collections of the print room. The original concept for the library intended this consultation room also for scholarly research due to its ideal lighting conditions and calmness. Since this room does not belong to the library, but has been transferred to the prints and drawings department, one needs the permission to work here. In terms of services offered to the user, there is a computer to perform research in the library catalogue right at the information desks of the staff at the room's entrance. Materials circulate from the stacks to the reading room at 6 intervals, being requested through an automatic call slip feature via our online catalogue, or one simply fills in a form. in order to use the library's catalog, the museum's website and databases, free Wi-Fi access to the internet is offered for one's laptop. But for consulting digital resources, including subscribed and restricted outside digital resources, such as the fully searchable databases as JSTOR and ArtIndex, 30 iPads are available for the user on request. To serve the general public, we even made available about 50 children's books on art and history in the reading room, besides a few thousand reference books and recent issues of about 100 periodicals on the shelves. Most books are stored in the extensive depot situated in the building's basement. Getting a requested book involves long ways for the staff. It's also the staff that is in charge of making copies or scans being requested on forms. The library holds one color copy machine and a book scanner, but not directly available to the user. The intention is to keep this library hall as empty as possible for the precise reason of maintaining the original ambience of the authentic 19th century. The special function room for copying, scanning, and microfilm are situated in the basement, immediately under the reading room. Nowadays, one might find much more museum visitors in the library hall than scholars. However, the number of scientific library users did not decline in comparison to the time before the reading room in the Great Library Hall opened its doors. But it appears that for the benefit of the reading room becoming a period room, the original function of the library suffered as a place for research. After a few weeks, I introduced some changes in the concept and implemented new rules. Visitors were no longer allowed to take pictures from the ground level between the reading desks. The library staff no longer approached each person entering the room in order to avoid noise. In addition to the already existing electronic museum app, printed information material on the library were planned to be distributed in front of the entrance of the library hall instead. On both front doors, on the ground level, signs were attached announcing these rules. To regulate the extremely heavy inflow of museum visitors into the reading room, sometimes over 700 visitors a day, a doorbell was attached to these doors. To conclude, one could say that this library is more designed as an icon in the local community. The architecture is fixated on the classic book-dominated library of the past. Because of its position inside the National Museum, there seems to exist a conflict between the educational and the scholarly needs. While the novel approach favors communication and rather addresses the museum visitor, the scholars have to cope with noise and flurry. It appears to be a constant struggle to achieve the specification of a modern research library and being a cultural monument at the same time. This problem has been recognized by the directors of the museum. Its implementation is a dynamic process that has to be continuously adjusted. In the near future, the Rijksmuseum will launch a fellowship program for pre-doctoral students to pursue dissertation research that shows a clear relation to the museum's collections and expertise. In this new vision, which has been launched only a week ago, the library will become the central meeting place and the research center for the fellows we hope to welcome every year. The new direction, hopefully, will be towards providing research resources and facilitating research, thus strengthening international research on Dutch art. Thank you very much.